Welcome to our special year-end tax in review tax sutra hangout, and we will not only review the year gone by in tax, but we'll also do a little bit of, not little bit, a lot of crystal ball gazing of what lies ahead for us in hopefully what will be another action-packed exciting year in tax. But what are the themes of the year gone by before I introduce the guests? I think if you summarize the entire year in one line, I think the one word, the operative word this year is poem. And we've had, in fact, three poems. We've had a poem called The Beps, which I think came out like a melody. You had another poem called The GST, which probably struck a discordant note a little bit. And you had the third poem, the actual poem, Draft Guidelines, which is somewhere in between. Apart from that, we have, of course, we have litigation, which is there. You have the government, which has, I think, walked the talk in a big way when it comes to non-adversarial tax regime and transfer pricing. I think you have the record number of APAs which the government has signed, and the intent is very clear, more to come in the next few months. These are the big ticket themes which we are going to discuss with a power-packed panel, starting from my left, Amay Kunte, partner, co-founder, Tax Sutra. Rohan Shah, the Managing Partner, Economic Laws Practice. You have P.V. Srinivasan, Corporate Advisor, former head of tax at Wipro. Gautam Doshi, one of the most renowned tax experts, Group MD Reliance, ADAG, and of course, Dinesh Kanabar, Managing Partner at Dhruva. Thanks so much all for joining us. I'll quickly start with Dinesh Bhai. Dinesh Bhai, how would you, you know, capture this year? What for you absolutely struck out?
You know, one of the key things which emerges to me is really that the amount of activism that one has seen from the government with a view to ensuring that the tax regime is not non-adversarial. So the number of circulars that have come by, the setting up of the committee for tax reforms, the AP Shah committee on MAT. So the number of steps that the government has taken is probably unprecedented. Equally, as I look at it, I find that, and I'm sure we'll discuss this as we go along, that there is still a gap between the intent of the government, which seems to be absolutely towards making tax laws as properly administrable as possible, but there is a gap between the government's intention and what is happening on the ground. Third, and the most important thing again which comes up is that we have seen so many of the APAs signed, you referred to that earlier. And more important, apart from APAs, one has seen bilateral APAs, and more important, the MAP regime, the way it has moved forward. It had almost come to a standstill, particularly with our key trading partner, USA. And this year we saw MAP move forward. So a lot of positive effort. And if I sit back and reflect that towards the end of the year, when we had this tax simplification committee come up, I'm looking forward to a fact that the budget this year is going to see really see radical changes in the tax arena, be it in terms of the roadmap for reduction of tax rates and the doing away with the incentives and deductions or whatever else. But I'm looking forward to a budget at this time will be very high in terms of changes that one will see in the tax arena.
Gautam bhai?
Yes, I would agree with what Dinesh is saying. We have a year where clearly government has shown its intent to try and go along with industry, to try and help industry, and yet in the performance things have altered somewhere or the other. Take for example the MAT on FIIs. Yes, you had the AP Shah committee, the final resolution is one which is what one wanted, an ideal resolution, but the number of steps which had to be gone through just to reach that resolution was uncalled for. Or take the date of filing the returns, a circular which industry wanted, which came, but came one day late, came again because of somebody somewhere in government not acting at the speed and in the manner in which the intent was there. Or take ICDS, which is going to be one of the key things, drivers going forward. That is perhaps the indicator of the second thing of government, that while the move is towards simplification, the move continues to be one of pure revenue bias. ICDS has got tremendous revenue bias at the cost of fairness. And that, I think, is something which needs to be guarded against. and hopefully the committee on simplification and the other moves which the government is making will take us towards that direction where we will not only have simplification but along with fairness.
Yeah, PBS sir.
Yeah, I will possibly state what Mr. Dinesh has already stated. I also carry the message that simplification efforts of the government are really commendable. I think the government has shown very clear indication that it would like to have simple laws, the administration to be non-adversarial, and I fully take that the government's directions are in the right place, but there's a gap. Once it goes down to the administration, you find that it is not in the same intensity. The government carries the message, it is not administered at the, say, at the assessing officer level. So I would expect perhaps six or eight months more before the administration also starts following what has been already stated at the policy level. And that is what is being achieved through the circulars, and even some circulars are giving a warning to the assessing officers, you can see. So I would say that these are very serious messages which are given to the administration to take the government seriously and act on simplification. And I would expect the government to act, enforce these simplification measures at the administration level. What I would possibly say on the ICDS is that it was possibly that the industry did not act promptly to tell the government that the ICDS is not required. Adequate pressure at the point it was about to come into force would have mitigated the damage it has already done. Although, of course, we have got feedback mechanism to give, but we already have the standards in force and it's advancing the income, which I do not know whether the government intended to do, but nevertheless, the administration intends to do.
Yeah. Rohan bhai, you know, last year was the year of litigation. What does this year, stand out for you?
My own sense is a little different and take a different view from what the others have said. You know, I'm pretty much looking at it in terms of the ground level realities and the sentiment of people doing business, and I don't think there's been a sea change there. I don't think you've seen a sudden surge of belief in the integrity of the tax system, and I think that is sometime coming. And the one thing I'm looking forward to is all of the good governmental action actually translating into a ground level belief in terms of the integrity of the tax system. The other thing is, much as we will look at the future of tax, I think litigation will continue to play an important role. And last year was significant from the perspective that, you know, in the Supreme Court, we had a truly outstanding bench of judges. And you saw a sort of disposal, both quantitative and qualitative, which we haven't seen for the past 10 years. And that made a huge difference, again, you know, in building assessee sentiment in terms of the faith in the system, although in this case, the sort of judicial system. And, you know, the big piece of news is going to be the GST, and we will all continue to follow it. And the whole political process, I think, you know, for most people is difficult to understand, and that will continue to play itself out. But what is also happening is the government is simultaneously coming through with different pieces of legislation, which are a guidance to what is to come. And in terms of what is to come, while, you know, a lot of people do believe that this will be very good for the economy, I believe that the detailing of the GST is going to play as important a role as the structure of the GST. And I think as of today, the signs on the detailing of the GST, although it is premature, are not leading to simplification. People have questions and people do foresee more complication in the future. So I think it's critical we get both things sorted, the whole constitutional position, the legislative position, but don't ignore the fact that, you know, assessees need to live with the detail of the GST, and that needs to be simplified. So I'm really looking forward to whether that happens.
Yeah, Amay, what are the key takeaways? You know, any key takeaways you got from the talk?
Sure. So we talked about proactive actions taken by the government on various aspects. I think in terms of the circulars, clearly the numbers tell out that there has been a significant increase in the number of circulars, almost 25% more in terms of the absolute count. There are two aspects, Arun, which according to me, 2015 is a special year. One is in terms of the litigation. So if you look at the overall statistics, again, the success ratio in favor of taxpayer continues to be over 60% before different levels of the court. But on the other hand, the clarification that came from government doubling the limits for filing the appeal, I think is significant. That will help in reducing the litigation burden. That's on the positive side. On the negative side, just one observation is the black money law. At the beginning of the year and since the last year in election, there's been a lot of expectation on actual delivery of black money law. At least in this this 9 months of this financial year, there hasn't been a much progress and a positive outcome of the black money law. Arun?
Yeah, I think let's go one by one. Let's take the new things that are coming in. And clearly there are three things that are there on the anvil. One is BEPS, which surely worldwide is going to have a big impact. So in India, then you have the black money law, you have the ICDS, and then you have the POEM. You clearly have four new things which corporate India has to grapple with. Let's get a take from each of the panelists, a quick 60 to 90 second take from each of the panelists on each of these laws. BEPS, black money law, ICDS, these three at least to begin with, and POEM. Your sense on all the four. Dinesh bhai, to start with you.
So if you look at the black money law, and I'll come to that first, here was a window of compliance which was opened up. And for whatever reason, if I may say so, at one place where the government did not seem to achieve the targets, even remotely, this was the one item. There are varying degrees of estimates of how much black money is around, but the government managed to collect less than 3,000 crores, with about 5,000 crores of disclosures, which everybody would agree is maybe a fraction of what money ought to have come in. There are various issues which come in there, and again, Arun, if I may just say this, the gap between the intent and implementation is again evident here. So here was a law which was so worded that people were very afraid as to whether the immunity extended merely to tax or to everything else. Rather than the government coming out and giving a reassurance to people that yes, if you come clean, you have nothing to worry about, the government actually came out more and more with a stick approach to say, if we find anything, we are going to be after you, we are not going to spare you, etc. And the stick approach did not seem to work. The last of the circulars clarifying that the money coming into the country for payment of taxes would not tantamount to violation of FEMA came 3 days before the last date on which the scheme was going. So again, a gap between policy, intent and implementation. Insofar as BEPS is concerned, it's going to be something which in some sense Indian Revenue would claim a big victory about, because a lot of what government has been saying seems to have been accepted at a policy level. One could see in the engagement of the government, the smile or the smirk on faces of the government officials to say, well, finally, people seem to agree with whatever we are saying. BEPS is going to put a huge compliance and a cost burden on the industry. We're going to look at country by country reporting, we're going to talk about master file, we're going to talk about 20 other things. So I think that's going to be another issue. And again, one is going to, it's never about the law. It's really about how do we administer and implement the law, which is going to be very, very critical. And finally, coming to the issue which you spoke about, POEM. So we began with place of effective management, and the final guidelines which have come out seem to veer towards a CFC. The CFC was around the corner. People anticipated a CFC to come in the coming budget. Instead of the CFC coming in the budget, what we now have is a circular, which by and large drives towards taxation of passive income overseas. Quite a few gaps out there really. Is the circular and the law consistent with each other? Are you really providing the degree of clarity which you wanted to? So as I just keep on harping this one thing, great policy, Rohan, I heard as a slightly different point of view, but I think there's a great policy out there, there's a great desire to make things happen. Ultimately, when we come to implementation, we see a huge gap out there.
Yeah, Rohan bhai, you know, before I get Gautam bhai on PBS on some of these items, you know, on GST, you know, where are we on GST? Let's assume that a miracle happens in the next session of Parliament, in the budget session, the GST actually goes through. Is India Inc. ready, Rohan bhai, for GST? And then I'll let Amay have a follow-up question with you. But is India Inc. ready? Are we on the right path as far as technology is concerned? Are the states geared up? Are our IT systems geared up? Are we logistically there in terms of preparedness?
Yeah, so I have three important issues. One, I think India Inc. has, you know, prepared in anticipation of GST so often that really now there is a little bit of a loss of belief. People are saying, you know, let it come and, you know, we'll then deal with it at that stage. So, you know, you find every 3 to 4 months there is frantic activity and then it abates. The second bit is critical, not only that, you know, we see the process in terms of the constitutional issues, but then it will have to go to the states, and then there is the whole legislative process, including the model law, which itself will draw a lot of comment and, you know, involve a lot of effort. I think industry will only fully understand all of the dimensions of GST when, you know, all of the relevant parts of the law are also effectively in the public domain. The last bit, you know, would be really what you talked about in terms of preparedness of IT systems and the corresponding preparedness of states, etc. And the issue over there is, you know, yes, I think the center has made rapid strides on the IT front. You know, the states are also in a degree of preparedness. But quite honestly, those issues are really tertiary to the fact that the primary issue is constitutional, then it's legislative. And in what we're seeing up to now, the situation is, you know, for valuation, they say that services as consumed in each state will be valued and will be taxed by that state. Now, can you imagine goods being carried from somewhere in the northeast to Karnataka, and you are basically trying to say that the traverse through each state by kilometer will determine what is taxed by each state? And if the two states actually, or two or more states, have a divergence, then, you know, there isn't even a mechanism today to settle it. So I think on GST, you know, a lot still to be done. Everybody is very, very hopeful. And I do believe the government must realize that wherever GST has been brought in, the transition period that you must give to industry is a minimum of 6 months after everything is in the public realm. So, you know, is industry ready? I would say guardedly so. But, you know, they will certainly up the gear when there is a greater belief in terms of the date and the rest of the issues being worked out.
Amay, any follow-up question to PVS sir and Gautam bhai on either?
Yeah, so just continuing with what Rohan said on GST preparedness, I think one is, of course, the overall constitutional framework, etc. But in between, in the middle of the year, mid-November, we saw introduction of Swachh Bharat CESS and making it non-credible. Gautam bhai, do you think that also gives a right signal that on one hand we are talking about GST introduction and on other hand you have a 0.5% cess which is creating a cascading tax effect as well?
No, clearly, I mean, the two are contradictory to each other. But then if the intention is to create a fund and a significant fund for Swachh Bharat, then that's the price which you have to pay for that. So I think Swachh Bharat is, while contradictory, intentional, intended, and clearly for a purpose which is different from the purpose of GST. GST will come, and even if GST comes, the Swachh Bharat CESS may continue. But take other things. I mean, coming back to the points on BEPS and POEM and things like that, take one of the key things which is coming up in the AS. Companies will have to shift to Ind AS. The question is, what is going to be the MAT impact? And we have been told that we will clarify, we will give you new rules which will take care of this. That is not again to be seen. So take BEPS, we don't really know how the law will be drafted, but that's true of virtually major part of the world, and therefore one can accept that. But take poem. The guidelines, as one may put it, have not really left anybody, I would think, much wiser than what the act was. It does not really give you anything new. So the net effect is to accept that poem is something which is difficult to implement, something which cannot really be enforced so easily, because the fallouts would be far more severe if an attempt is made to enforce it. And perhaps the real solution is a CFC. And if that is the truth, then let government accept it, just as they accepted saying MAT on FIIs, and accept that instead of poem, we would rather introduce a CFC, which will achieve our objective and give objective criteria to industry so they know where they stand. They know what taxes.
Gautam bhai, can I ask you, interrupt you, sorry, for a minute. Why aren't we seeing a furor on a poem like we saw for Gar?
Because I think the way it is coming through, it looks like poem will be closer to the Black Money Act, something which is more of noise than real effect. I can't really see poem actually causing any significant difficulty either to Indian MNCs or to foreign MNCs. Most foreign MNCs should not be concerned with poem. With the guidelines the way they are, I can't see how you are ever going to establish that a board of directors is not doing its job genuinely or honestly and is being guided by somebody else. Factually impossible. And if that is impossible, then poem really is a dead letter. It is more of noise than real effect. And that's perhaps not really becoming such a major issue.
Yeah, okay, fine. PVS sir, A, do you agree with Gautam bhai? And number two, anything about BEPS, say your former company Wipro, would fall within the threshold of CBC reporting, I assume, quite easily. So are companies like Wipro, Infosys, TCS and the likes, the Reliance groups, are all of them prepared for CBC reporting? I mean, and of course, anything about BEPS that concerns you?
The concern is only compliance cost. I do not think that, in thought, all the things which BEPS has said is already there in the minds of most MNCs. So how to document it and keep it on record, and that would possibly enhance the compliance cost. And it is not about transparency. Transparency was always there. And even when we are handling global tax issues across even developed countries, they would like to understand what the head office is doing and what the branches are doing, or what the holding company is doing and what the subsidiary companies are doing. If they are made available even in the past, except that it document, now possibly we have to reduce them into a single document, and that is the difficulty. So it's a compliance cost which is worrying. If I have is that India may possibly go and implement country by country reporting, just assume that the US does not take the same legislation in the same form in which India is doing, then we will have a unilateral measure which will be possibly putting a burden on Indian businesses, but not necessarily putting a similar businesses burden on the US businesses which are coming into India. So it will not be a bilateral arrangement, but it will be a unilateral arrangement. And that is worrying for me. That means that Indian outward going companies will be liable to CBC. They will keep a master file, they will keep local files as required by the Indian law. But a US company need not keep a master file, they can have a local file for India, because the US law may not mandate the CBC regulations as is intended by OECD. So you will have a situation of unilateral cost being created for the Indian export, but not having a bilateral arrangement with US. So I'll be worried that it will be discriminatory to that extent. And if that discrimination is also removed, then possibly we are on par with OECD recommendation. On the place of effective management, I think it essentially reflects all the attributes of CFC, except that it has not taken the rate of taxation, which is possibly the dominant reason for CFC. So it is CFC without the rate of taxation. So we have double negative, if I may say. got the POEM negative and also the CFC without the rate being the criteria for determining whether a company will be regarded as resident or not. So I would possibly have taken the rate of taxation also into consideration. Possibly, instead of the nomenclature being POEM, it could have been even understood as CFC. Let's not go with the nomenclature. The intent possibly is to bring CFC law through POEM mechanism. I would also say, instead of giving negative conditions, positive conditions would have been helpful. We can say not less than 50% of assets in India. I would have said not to company, positive conditions rather than negative conditions. For example, if I have a US subsidiary, which is earning only passive income, now by virtue of these rules, by force it is a resident in India by applying POEM because it has got passive income. So the first criteria itself is met. Now US company is taxed fully in the US. You don't need place of effective management to bring that company into tax in India. Give a foreign tax credit for that company, administer it, for no revenue gain. So I will be a little more practical to find out which are the companies they want to really attract. So normally it is very useful for most MNCs to put a holding company in a country like US and have many operating companies under that holding company, because that model works in a consolidation benefit is available in the US. So they are not looked at separate entities for the purposes of US taxation. They may be looked at separate entities for Indian taxation for a moment. So your holding company in the US may be treated as a resident by applying POEM. So you will have a situation that perhaps the POEM is not intending to tax, but nevertheless is covered by the draft regulations which have been proposed.
Yeah. Am I anything for Dinesh Bhai on make in India?
More than Make in India, just continuing with BEPS theme, and it has a linkage to the Make in India, and there's a direct tax and an indirect tax aspect in the digital economy. 2015, there was a lot of expectation that OECD will do something relating to digital economy, but finally what we have is that just options on the table with no resolution, and many of the countries across the world are implementing unilateral measures to tax digital economy. Take France, UK, Australia. So Dinesh Bhai, from a income tax point of view, will it create a multilateral disorder, if I may say so, while taxing the digital economy, each country taking individual steps? And the follow-up question to Rohan Bhai is also taxing VAT applicability on these digital economy transactions is also an equally important issue. Some thoughts on that. So Dinesh Bhai, your comments on digital economy.
You know, if I could just, with your time permission, while dealing with digital economy, actually make a point on BEPS and a larger issue which Pancho
answered. Yeah.
So India is actually at a crossroad at this point of time when it concerns taxation. It will be interesting to see how India is able to resolve this crossroad in the year that comes ahead. And let me elaborate what I mean. On the one hand, there is a recognition that we need huge amount of foreign investment in this country to get the economy going further that it deserves to achieve, number one. Number two, here is a prime minister going all over the world, inviting foreign investment and getting a feedback that tax is one of those key barriers to foreign investment in the country. So the effort, and we spoke about number of circulars, et cetera, that the government has come out with to say, how do we communicate to the world that India truly wants to make a tax regime simple? On the other hand, you have number of things. You have GAR, which is going to be effective from 1st April 17. Now, is GAR consistent with India's objectives of making tax laws simple? Should we push back GAR by a couple of years? And I'm not making this a open statement. I have actually spoken to members of the Tax Simplification Committee, and on their own they have come back to say that they believe that GAR needs to be pushed back. Whether it will happen, not happen, I don't know. I'm not certainly making a case. I'm just putting the crossroad issue as opposed
that's
to
your wish list. Whether Dinesh or not. That's your Christmas. That's your New Year wish list. Come on, Dinesh Bhai.
No, it's not that. So one is the simplification plan that the government has consistent with GAR? How are we going to look at the fact that we still have continuing ambiguity on Mauritius and Singapore treaty, and with BEPS recommending that there cannot be a double non-taxation arising out of tax treaties And again, what are we wanting to do in and around that? And I think that's where the country needs to really come to grips with. You spoke about Make in India. And really, if you say Make in India, and there are several who believe that this entire thrust of Make in India probably is misdirected, given where China is today in terms of manufacturing, etc. And I'm not making that political comment. All that I'm saying is, on the one hand, you are trying to tell the world that we want to make a simplified tax regime. On the other hand, there are global imperatives. So to the point which you made, Ame, here is the Google tax which is being introduced in UK, Australia is doing whatever it is doing, and really some of these issues is where India has been already making noise much before many other countries did. That said, how is this consistent with our growth aspirations? What are we communicating to the world? Coming just to the point on digital economy, I would say that clearly, BEPS, if there was one area where BEPS did not make any progress of any significance, it's on the digital economy. It just left the matters as it is. It spoke about permanent establishment and how the nuance of permanent establishment could change, how place of business could change really, but did not really come out and left it to say that we are an implementation committee which will look at it. And I'm very, very sure that India will be keenly watching what the OECD comes out with on BEPS. I'm going to just make one practical point, and I go back to 1998 or 99, when one of the credit card companies was sought to be assessed to tax in India, and a commissioner appeals in 1999 passed an order talking about digital economy and saying that when you swipe a credit card in India and you get an authorization, which authorization emanates from a server which is based out of the USA, it is almost that the server is actually relocated to India because of instant connectivity, and therefore there is a permanent establishment in India. This goes way to 1999, Commissioner Appeals Order, which eventually got overturned by Income Tax Appellate Tribunal. So India has been aggressive in terms of its approach on taxation of digital economy. I'm very sure Rohan would have a number of points to make there on VAT implications, but really India will be looking forward to what OECD comes out on this subject.
Rohan bhai, e-commerce taxation and IDT route has been, you know, that's been what's been talked about as a solution. Tax e-commerce via the VAT route.
Yeah, so, you know, two things. Firstly, I think while, you know, rightly we're talking about Make in India, taxation as a component of that, etc. I think there are very, very critical parts to Make in India that sometimes we ignore. I think the first factor of Make in India is not about infusing more FDI into India to Make in India, but about retaining the FDI and the local investment which is already in the manufacturing sector or is in the services sector. And I think a lot of the tax policy and administration is actually harming the sentiment even for people to stay in India. So let's just take the entirety of that e-commerce industry, right? You have two sets of issues which have complicated this for everybody. One is the transaction actually a transaction of sale, and if so, who is responsible for the sale? Then you have the situation in terms of can a service tax also be applied? Because the way in which people have structured themselves is to say I'm a platform providing a service, but somebody else actually conducts a sale. The net result of this has been that these transactions are suffering both a VAT and also suffering a service tax, and therefore both these taxes, which are seemingly inconsistent because one is on the factum of sale, the other is on the factum of service, but both these are being levied. Then you have the situation in terms of state of origination and destination state, who should have the right to tax, and I can tell you as a firm, we probably have about 60 odd cases where the situation is that both the origination state and the destination state are seeking to tax. So at this point of time, we have a state of uncertainty, and as typically happens in our system in a state of uncertainty, everybody has put up their hand to say, I have a right to tax. And as a result, you not only are getting, as I said, a VAT and a service tax, you're also getting more than one point of taxation in more than one state. So as far as we are concerned just now, every opportunity to tax by everyone who could tax is really seeming to come to fore. And from that perspective, you know, the earlier we can get clarity, the better. And the more we have these issues, where ultimately an assessee believes that the only recourse is a court, like is happening in the 60-odd cases I'm mentioning, the worse it is for the credibility of our tax system. Because if every tax issue ultimately is only going to get sorted out by courts, I think the whole situation of the dream of Make in India, etc., we are placing an unduly large burden in terms of people's expectations to say, you know, yes, India has various benefits, but some of these issues like tax just completely color the picture. So to my mind, we are in a state of
confusion. No wonder one way that some of these e-commerce companies are based out of Singapore and others. You rarely have any of these companies, including Flipkart, who are based out of India.
You know, and which is why, again, as you said, indirect taxation is what is going to be used as the weapon. Because ultimately, there is going to be an identified buyer over here. And everybody is going to be in a race to try and somehow tax that piece, which has the India nexus. And, you know, not only tax it once, but if it's possible to tax it more than once, people will certainly make an honest attempt to do that.
Yeah. Amay, you know, before we get PVS in and we'll start winding up the show now, you know, on the litigation front, I just got some statistics. Thanks to the tax bench that Rohan Bhai mentioned, and that was quite big. You know, we missed that out in the beginning of the show. Thanks, Rohan Bhai, for pointing that out. We had over 100 judgments on the indirect tax front and over 40 on direct tax from the Supreme Court tax bench that only we reported. So there would have been a few hundred judgments more that would have come from the tax bench of Justice Rowington Nariman and Justice A.K. Sikri. And there's no two ways about it that the bench did an absolutely fabulous job. The worry is that the bench has now been broken up. You know, at least the first indicators that we are getting for the new year, after vacation when the Supreme Court resumes, is that the bench may not be there. Does that worry you, Rohan Bhai, quickly?
Well, I won't say it worries me, but what that bench achieved, and you know, the statistic is actually closer to about 360 disposals and qualitative disposals. So what worries me is that the chemistry that that bench had, that was something quite remarkable and, as I said, unprecedented, at least for the last 15 to 20 years. The fact that we have broken it up, to me, raises an issue. Not that there are not other judges who have the ability to deliver a similar quality of justice, but when you have a bench which is achieving so much, you must query the factor that, you know, why would you split it up? Both of them are still sitting judges. Both of them are in different assignments. And, you know, you will always query this fact that 1 year more of this bench, what could it have actually achieved? So, you know, others may be able to deliver something similar, but you had something almost unprecedented going in your favor, and for whatever reason, we've tinkered with it.
Yeah. Amay, the Gautam Bhai and then PVS, sir, top three judgments of the year for you. Let's go into the rapid fire round. Top.
Yeah, so Arun, Maruti judgment from Transupai Singh, the Wipro judgment on foreign tax credit, and the judgment from GVK reiterating the source principles. These are, according to me, the three top judgments of 2015.
PVS, sir?
Obviously, Wipro scores because of the foreign tax credit issue. And I would have uttered it even in my dream, if I say. What I liked, Arun, is not a single judgment. What I see is a series of legal precedents which are being revisited. Just to illustrate that the leasing company, it is the lessor who is entitled to depreciation, has been reiterated. And this decision comes at a point when ICDS is also operating. So you find that the Supreme Court reiterates that the lessor is entitled to depreciation. It ignores the facts that the lessee is entitled to depreciation, which is what the ICDS is trying to reposition for finance leases. Now we have to reconcile these two decisions. I mean, one of the ICDS and the other of the Supreme Court. Obviously, I think the Supreme Court scores for the ICDS. So I think these are decisions. Another principle which was wonderful for me to read, these are the principles we learned very early in our career, is the functional test for an asset, whether it's a grant or not a grant. again it got reiterated in one of the decisions where it said a pond should be used for rearing prawns, then that pond also will be a plant and not a building. Now these are the things we learned very early in our career. When you see the Supreme Court articulating the same principle all over again, say 25 years later, that is real nostalgia of what I can say. Another very unique principle that if WDB has got discontinued business, then still it will be entitled to depreciation. That was a decision which came to the Bombay High Court. Again, a pleasant reading, because your concept of block of assets, you cannot now find out the individual assets within a block. This was again a welcome decision to the Bombay High Court. I liked quite a few principles. The greatest of them all, which may be more in the context of a wealth tax rather than income tax, that how do you measure a distance for agriculture land, whether it's by crow flies or you measure it by the road. And once the court said that it is by the road and crow flies, I think again it was a good reading to know how distance should be measured. So I enjoyed all the decisions of 2015 for the reason that all these decisions are a reflection of the past, with some of them I could connect back to 25 years.
Yeah, Gautam bhai, any nostalgia for you?
More than nostalgia, I would rather go to the other side. There are decisions which naturally get one worried. And I would put the Delhi High Court on Abhinandan investment on GAR.
Oh, that's big.
The judicial GAR has already come to stay. You have rekindled McDowell, you have rekindled GAR. We debated earlier whether GAR should be pushed back by a year or two for the purpose of simplification and to be in line with the overall tax policy. But with judicial GAR, do you really need GAR at all? And with the way the Delhi High Court has looked at it, in a case where you have an actual transaction, you have put through, you have actually bought, you have actually sold, you don't deny the fact of purchase and sale, but you reject it merely because it is purchased and sold within a group, and therefore, while vis-a-vis an individual company, the company has not bought and sold, it's not in the same position, the group is. And you then say that for that reason the losses will not be allowed. Now then you really have a difficult situation. So I would think in a sense it is nostalgic because it goes back to the type of furor of the problems which McDowell created, and I would expect the Delhi High Court decision really to lead further in that direction, at least for all intra-group transactions in a big way. On the other hand, the decisions on transfer pricing and particularly on AMP, I think, are clear, setting out very clearly that the judiciary is not, carved down is not really going to give you only something which the executive wants or going to find a means to tax, and where there is a strong justification for not levying a tax will not be levied or an income will not be assessed. So I think it's on both directions that one is seeing, as usual, the judicial decisions coming.
Yeah, we'll have a quick, thanks so much, quick closing comments from each of our panelists, starting with Dinesh Bhai. Dinesh Bhai, what should we expect from the Income Tax Simplification Committee? 30 seconds, what should we expect?
I would expect a number of things. One of the things in their mandate is to be revenue neutral. I would therefore expect them to come back with a number of things like how can dividend distribution tax be creditable in the hands of shareholders? How do you resolve the 112 section conflict on 10%, 20%, what constitutes security? So a number of these provisions which have been engaging us needlessly, I would expect them to come out. I would also expect them to put some sense into administration, as for example, activating the multiple benches of the AAR and sort of ensuring quicker disposition of many of the matters.
Yeah. Gautam bhai, what should we expect on GST next year? What is your expectation?
Sorry?
Gautam bhai, what should we expect on GST next year?
On GST?
Yeah. Another year of wait?
Hello?
Yeah. So Gautam bhai, what should we expect on GST next year?
I would think that GST will become a reality. It may not happen as soon as what government wants it. It will not certainly happen in April 16, but by April 17. And for that purpose, as Rohan said and as others have put it, we may have the full law with all the background much earlier than that. And if that also comes through next year, that would be a great development. And I hope to see that in the middle of next year, by September, October next year.
Yeah. PVS, sir, on BEPS, where will be next year? This next December, will we have made a lot of progress? Will the multilateral instrument have been signed by over 40 countries, which will, at one stroke of a pen, which will renegotiate thousands of tax treaties? PVS, sir.
That is a very overarching expectation. I would possibly be very happy if the local laws are not constructed in such a manner which would increase the cost of burden only on Indian companies, without putting a commensurate burden on those who are coming to India. Number one, investment should be encouraged. At the same time, it's not that the outward investments alone should be discouraged. If I have to use place of effective management, it actually discourages outward investments. And if the circular has not removed all the difficulties for outward investments, likewise, I find this will not be hurting outward investments. And India's export should not be hurt, is my submission at this point.
Rohan, what is going to be the litigation trend after 12 months? Non-adversarial regime in reality, lesser cases, which is not good news for you, of course, Rohan, come on.
My own sense is that hopefully a lot of what is being done will create a situation where, there is lesser scope for litigation. But if you look at what's happened in the past and project it into the future, I cannot believe that there will be bad news for us. Unfortunately, there will probably be bad news for the assessees. There is increased revenue pressures. Interpretations are still going to go the way they are, and I can't see the trend abating. All I am really hoping for is if we have more qualitative judgments and next year we see a move to better tax administration, then hopefully 2-3 years hence we can really begin to believe that tax litigation is going to abate, but I can't see that abating in the next 1 year.
Yeah, Rohan, by past is a prologue. Amay, final word from you.
Yeah, Arun, just one interesting observation. Last 45 minutes, we probably have spent less than a minute on the subject of transfer pricing. So I think this year has been, it's been really steady and stable on the subject of transfer pricing, and let's hope that continues in 2016. I think just one point, taking learnings from APAs, particularly, I think the government may consider safe harbor revision. I think that's something which will really be something very interesting and will soothe the nerves for MNCs.
That is already happening, Amit, just for your information. So sure. The government has constituted a committee. Comments have been invited on the safe harbor.
Right.
And it is expected that before end January, the new set of numbers will come out.
Right.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much, everyone, for joining us. Rohan Bhai, PVS Sir, Gautam Bhai, Dinesh Bhai, and wishing all our viewers a very happy, prosperous, successful, exciting, and tax-filled 2016. Thank you, everyone. We'll be back. See you in the new year. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Arun. And wish you and your Tax Sutra team the same.
Thank you.
Thank you.